Hello everyone, welcome to Education in Hands. If you see, in our last video, we learned about the introduction to limit state design of steel structures, difference between analysis and design, then what are the materials we are using in design, then steel, its chemical composition, and different types of structural steel. Now, in this class, let us learn about the properties of steel and what are the physical properties and mechanical properties of the steel. So first, what are the properties of steel? See, the properties of steel required for engineering design are classified as physical and mechanical properties. So first, if we see the physical properties, according to the clause 2.2.4 of IS 800-2007, physical properties of a steel, irrespective to its grade, whatever the grade it is, physical properties of steel are given as like this: unit mass equal to 7850 kg per meter cube, maximum stress in compression will be equal to 250 megapascals, maximum stress in tension equal to 250 megapascals, maximum stress in shear equal to 144 megapascals, and also Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity is given as 2 × 10⁵ megapascals or 2 × 10⁵ Nm². And coefficient of linear expansion is given as 12 × 10⁻⁶ per degree centigrade. And if we see the Poisson's ratio, in elastic range it is considered as 0.3 and in plastic range it is considered as 0.5. If you see it in brief, IS 800 code in clause 2.2.4.1, these physical properties are given like this. Then next, if we see the mechanical properties, the principal mechanical properties of the structural steel which are important in design are given as ultimate strength or maximum tensile strength, then yield stress or proof stress, ductility, which is an important mechanism for steel, then toughness, how much it is absorbing, then weldability, how good we can weld the material, corrosion resistance, how good we are going to resist the member against corrosion, and machinability, how good we are modifying it into our required shape. So all these mechanical properties mainly depends on these following characteristics. That is, first, chemical composition. What is the major chemical composition of the material? Then rolling methods. How we are rolling, whether it is a hot rolled product or cold rolled product. Then next, rolling thickness. What is the rolling thickness? When a member is rolled, what is its thickness? Like, what is its web thickness? What is its flange thickness? Likewise, its rolling thickness also affects the mechanical properties of the material. Then heat and other treatments. How we are going to cool that product after rolling, or how we are heating or reheating it. This is also affect the mechanical properties of the material. And the last one is stress history. What are the stresses we are producing in the member, like tensile stresses or compressive stresses or any other stresses which are acting on the member. All these properties affect the mechanical properties of the material. So here, from ultimate strength to machinability, these mechanical properties are divided into two categories. So first are ultimate strength, yield stress, and ductility. These are associated with the structural engineering point of view in case of design. Means, if I want some strength, then I have to check with these mechanical properties: ultimate strength, yield stress, and ductility. Otherwise, if I want to check another, like serviceability criteria, like toughness, weldability, corrosion resistance, and machinability associated with the fabrication and durability of the material, which is nothing but serviceability of the material. So let us see one by one these mechanical properties. So first, ultimate tensile strength. See, ultimate tensile strength is nothing but the maximum stress at which the specimen fails by fracture in tensile test. So here, if we see this figure of stress strain curve for a mild steel specimen, so here I am having the maximum stress or peak stress. The stress which is coming here is called the ultimate strength or ultimate tensile strength. The next, yield stress or yield strength. So yield stress is the first level of stress at which strain increases without increase in stress. Means strain is continuously increasing. If we see here from this point, strain is continuously increasing up to here without any increase in stress. Means the body is perfectly in plastic state. So the starting point at which body loses its elastic nature and behaves as a plastic member, that peak point is called yield stress or yield strength point. So here at this point, body loses its elastic nature. Next one is ductility. So if you see here, from origin to end, member is giving the strain this much, means it is very large. So the beautiful concept in case of steel is its ductile nature. If you see what is meant by ductility, it is the property of the material by which it can deform before fracture without any significant loss in strength or stiffness. So before fracture, body tends to deform. That is the main advantage in steel, that is ductility. So how we are measuring this ductility? The percentage elongation in the specimen after the tensile test will refer to the ductility. So these three properties, ultimate strength, yield stress and ductility, all these three are identified in the tensile testing of a specimen. The next, if we see toughness. Toughness, it is the ability of the steel to resist fracture under impact loading. Whenever a member is loaded with certain impact, then the ability of the steel to resist the fracture is called toughness. The area under the stress strain curve is the measure of toughness. So whenever we are saying a member is tough, then we will calculate the area under its stress strain curve. Toughness is an important design criteria for the structure subjected to impact loads like earthquakes. Whenever a structure is designed in earthquake prone areas, then the member or the material of the member should be tough enough to resist that impact loading. Next one is weldability. Weldability is like the ability of welding. Here we are facing one problem that is called lamellar tearing. It is a form of brittle failure that may occur in certain welded joints. If welding is not done properly, then what will happen here? A tearing pattern will happen on the steel members. If we see here, there is a tearing after welding. Or if we see here, there is a tearing. So this kind of tearing pattern is called as lamellar tearing. This is due to the brittle failure of the member at the joint. In case of large welds, tear can occur due to the shrinkage strain from welding operations. Why? Because very high heat is involved in it. To overcome this effect, a sequence of welding to minimize the shrinkage strains are practiced in the practical applications to control the lamellar tearing. Next one is corrosion resistance. We all know steel is prone to corrosion. Whenever we are taking a steel structure, the main problem with the steel structure is its maintenance. Why? Because it is easily corroded. So most common method of protecting a steel member involves the use of paint or metallic coating. Here, if the steel is prepared with 0.2 to 0.5 copper content, then it will improve its resistance to corrosion. Along with carbon, If it is mixed with copper from 0.2 to 0.5%, then it is showing very good resistance against corrosion. And next, weathering steels contain great amount of phosphorus, chromium and copper, which can be used directly without painting. Like if we see the structural steel in the last video, where we are having weathering steels, that weathering steels can also be used as corrosion resistant steels. Next one is residual stresses. So here, residual stresses are like the stresses which are occurred in a member at the time of rolling due to uneven heating and cooling. So this steel products are hot rolled products. Whenever there is an uncertainty in temperature, like when it is not cooled properly or when it is heated differentially, then this residual stresses are produced in the member. Similarly, when a member is subjected to high temperatures during the fabrication by welding, at that time also this residual stresses are produced in the member. And also when members are cut by flame, if we are using oxy flames to cut the members, then the heat produced at the cutting edge will increase rapidly compared to other part. So then also residual stresses are produced in the members. So to remove this residual stresses which are produced in the member, it is possible only by subsequent reheating and slow cooling. And also one type of steel, that is quenched and tempered steels, have less residual stresses. Then the last one is stress concentration. So what is the stress concentration? It occurs in a member when there are irregularities in its geometry. So if you see here we are having an I section beam. So top we are having a flange, bottom we are having a flange, in middle we are having a web. So from flange to web, the change in shape leads to occurrence of stress concentration at its joint points. So this abrupt change in the geometry of the material will give stress concentration in the material. And sometimes we may put holes for our riveting or bolting. At that time also, stress concentration will increase at that places where there is a loss in the material. And also it causes an interruption to the flow of stress. But in general designs, we are neglecting that kind of stress concentration. So this is regarding the mechanical properties and physical properties of the steel. Then what are the different types of hot rolled steel products? We will see in the next video. Thank you.